It's always nice to have the orchestra here. Thank you so much. Wow. I cannot imagine the number of hours represented by your sitting here on this stage. And you parents, thank you. The last time I checked, most instruments get practiced because parents exist. So thank you so much. Wow. I am glad that you're here this morning. I'm glad the sunshine decided to pay us a visit. How lovely. And we have some announcements to share with you. Tomorrow, at Cypress Adventist School at 10 o'clock in the morning, you are invited to come and pull weeds and do all sorts of other things. An annual cleanup day tomorrow at Cypress Adventist School, 10 in the morning till 3 in the afternoon. And then, for some of us, there's going to be a juggling act. We're going to have to slip out of the cleaning bee early because George, come and talk to us about Victor. Victor Smiley.
I know when you see me take the microphone that I'm going to give you a talk about somebody who's died, who used to be here long ago, things like that. Well, this one is a person who's very much alive and who has been very important in the life of Green Lake Church. Now, he is not one of the originals. We had been operating for about 20 or 30 years before he came, but I was the one who invited him. By a choice of the committee, they said, you go ask him to be our organist. We had had, interestingly, very few organists, but they lasted a long time. Dr. Grauman, of course, set the tone between North Church and here. He was organist for 30 years straight. Anyway, when I went to talk to Vic, he had just come back from a very good career back on the East Coast. In fact, he was all over the range of music. He was a specialist, an expert on Gershwin. He was superb with jazz, big band, but he especially loved classical music. Then when I came and phoned him to see if he would be our organist here, he said, I would love to play in Green Lake. But George, there's one special thing. You folks have been having a very easy time of it with your organists. I am very much opposed to having professional musicians asked to play for free. I want to be paid. I said, gulp. We are in a kind of a low trough financially, and we've been having trouble meeting the expenses, and to add that to it would, He said, it isn't the money. I want the respect for our professional musicians. So he said, I tell you what I'll do. You pay me. I will endorse the check and give it right back to you. But I want it month after month, every time. Okay, I will think about that. I'll take it back to the committee. And I talked to Elder Bush, who was then our pastor, and we knocked it back and forth. What will be the effect of this if we do start paying him, even though we do have the question of how are we going to raise the money? Well, we did decide a couple of things that it wasn't too important right then. If he's going to take the check, we will have it show up as an expense on the financial statements. But if he gives it back to us, it will also show up in the revenues, and it will be a wash for the church. For him, well, yeah, it'll be about the same. A little bit of things of payroll taxes would diminish his part of it. But at any rate, right now, it won't be a problem, but we need to prepare so that in subsequent years, we have it in the budget that we are going to pay the organist. There it is. He was the one. He started us as getting the professionals paid. I thought you'd like to know that about him. Now, unfortunately, this grew rather quickly. We were going to have a very small group of us meet at the adult home where he lives. But when we outgrew the living room, we had to go somewhere else, so then we moved to the chapel here at the Green Lake Church. Tomorrow, I know this is sudden, tomorrow at 2 p.m., We will be meeting in the chapel in honor of a very important person. You know, they say the good dies, the evil lives after men, but the good dies with their bones. But this is going to be something he has made an effect on Green Lake Church that you may not see, but those of us on the finance committee see it every month in the financial statements.
Thanks, George. So, 2 o'clock tomorrow afternoon here. Tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock, we'll be celebrating Victor Smiley's 99th birthday. Hope you can join us. Oh, George, you wanted to know how many people were planning to come. Could I see the hands of those who plan to be here? I think I see about 10 hands, George. Okay. Thank you. That's helpful. On Wednesday, we go to Northwest Harvest, our monthly trip to Northwest Harvest. Announcements here in your bulletin. Hans, talk to us about next Sabbath.
Sabbath, everyone. So next Sabbath, I'm excited for next Sabbath because Dominique Davis will be here. And Dominique Davis is the founder of Community Passageway. Community Passageway is an organization that he established, he developed, that helped troubled youth that were used to be in juvenile centers, and he will be bringing them to next Saturday at 9:30 for Sabbath school. So they will be sharing their testimonies, and also for divine service as well. They'll be sharing their testimonies, telling them how Community Passageway has helped them grow and kept them out of trouble. So please come out at 9:30 for Sabbath school, and also for the divine service, he'll be speaking with his youth. Thank you.
Thanks, Hans. You know, I get one of my dreams is, you know, make a difference. That's why you become a preacher, make a difference. And here's the guy who's making a difference you can really see in the lives of these young people. Be great stories, it'll be inspirational. So I hope you can be here next week for Sabbath school and for the church service. March 10, next Sabbath, in the evening, Edmonds Evergreen Pathfinders. And some of you are going, well, that's Edmonds. Yeah, but 6 of our kids are in the club. So next Sabbath evening, March 10, Edmonds Evergreen Pathfinders will be putting on a talent show at the Edmonds Church. So you might want to be there. And all right, let's see. Did I do all of my announcements? I think I did. So now I want to invite you to stand, greet one another, pass God's peace here in God's house. I'm going to invite you to find your seats. I'm going to invite you to find your seats. And you might want to find your hymnals because we will be doing the call to worship together with the choir, with the organ and orchestra, I think, right? Yes, okay. Alex? Let's pray. Lord of creation, thank you for the glory of spring, the bursting of blossoms, the rising of tulips and daffodils from the ground. Lord of the nations, we pray that you will hasten the day when life instead of death will flow through the nations, when spears will be turned into pruning hooks and swords are turned into plowshares and justice rolls down like the great river. Lord of the cosmos, order all things far and near according to your good pleasure. Lord of our hearts, so shape and mold us that in the week to come we may act as agents of your kingdom to work for justice and peace, for hope, help, and healing is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
The offering today is for the local church budget. One of the churches in Berrien Springs, the Berrien Springs area, was planning a mission trip to the Dominican Republic. About 3 days before they were to leave, the organizer of the trip, a Spanish pastor in the area, called another pastor and said that something important had come up. He was not going to be able to go as their translator, and would the other pastor consider going in his place? This former missionary who knew Spanish well said that he would go. Just 3 days to pack. As he was preparing a suitcase and thinking about the destination, he remembered a beaten-up old baseball glove that was taking up space in his closet. Baseball is very much in the blood of Dominican boys, and a fortunate few find it to be a ticket to residence in the United States and maybe even into the Baseball Hall of Fame. During his time there, the pastor prayed and watched for just the right man to appear. And sure enough, a 14-year-old boy caught his eye. He had been extremely helpful at the construction site every day without fail. On the last day of the project, the pastor called him over and presented that baseball glove. The boy was thrilled. To him, it was worth $1 million. Well, for the pastor, it was just a throwaway item from his closet. Worth and value are attributed. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. As you consider your monetary resources, how much are they worth in light of eternity? May the deacons come forward. Let's bow our heads. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that we can always trust in you. You are an abundant God, and out of your great mercy, you have given us so much. We give you this offering today. With it, we worship you and give you our whole selves. Please now take it and use it for your kingdom and for your glory. Extend and multiply its reach and influence, we pray. May it be a blessing to many. We ask all of this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. How many of you have a grandma or a grandpa? Oh, good, everyone. That's great. How many of you have grandmas and grandpas that like to tell you stories? Yeah. My grandpa loved to tell us stories. And he really liked to tell us stories about how God helped him. So I'm going to pass on one of his stories to you. So this happened when my grandpa was going to school to become a minister. And due to some issues that came up, he had to take a break. So he had to leave Washington, D.C. at Emmanuel Mission College, and he moved to Mason City, Iowa, which is quite a ways away. There was a man there, Dr. Bascom, who had a farm. But because he was a doctor, he needed help to take care of the farm. So my grandpa and his wife, my grandma, and then their daughter Kathy, who was 5, their daughter Sandy, who was 3, that's my mom, and little baby Cheryl, they all moved to Iowa. And this story happens in April. It was a cold day in April. And April is springtime. What do you think happens at the farm in spring? Yeah. Things are growing, and what do you need to do to help things grow? You need water and plant the seeds, yeah. And you need sunshine too. All of those are important. So this day, my grandpa was getting out to get the fields ready to plant the seeds. So he got the tractor ready, and then he hooked up a plow, and the plow takes the hard ground all winter long, and it cuts it up. And then behind the plow was a harrow, and that has smaller metal discs to take the big clumps and make them into little clumps. So he could put the seed out, and then it would grow. So he gets the tractor, and he spends the morning taking care of the fields over here. Oh, I should back up. They're at a big farm. This is not like the raised beds at the back of my garden. This is like lots and lots of fields. There were cows, and then there were fields to grow the food for the cows. So there was a house and fields, and then there was a hill and more fields. So it was a lot of work. So he'd finished the fields over here by the house, and then he was getting ready to go and do the fields farther out. So at the top of the hill, there's a railroad track and a road, and then more fields. So he goes up, tractor goes across the railroad tracks, the plow goes behind the railroad tracks, but the harrow got stuck. So Grandpa gets off the tractor, and he goes to pick the harrow up. One of the little blades had just got stuck in the tracks. So he goes to lift it, but uh-oh, he'd made a mistake. He forgot to set the brake on the tractor. And when he lifted up the harrow, the whole thing rolled back, and it trapped Grandpa. So now we've got railroad track, my grandpa's leg, and the harrow. And it's very heavy, and it's very cold, and he is all by himself. Whew! He checks his watch. It's 3:00. And here's one thing you could always count on at this farm, the 4:00 train. Every day, always on time. So he has 1 hour to get off the tracks. Whew! He looks down the hills, the farmhouse, and he's thinking, well, maybe Kathy and Sandy will go out and play. There's some swings outside, and I can get their attention. So he's yelling and yelling, but it's a cold day. So they stayed inside, and they were in the kitchen on the other side of the house with my grandma. So they didn't hear him. So he's like, okay, got another plan. I'll take off my coat, even though it's cold, because maybe I could wave it, and then it'll be easier for someone to see me. And if someone goes by on this little road, maybe they'll see me, and they can stop, and they can get me out. So he takes off his coat, and he's waving it up in the air, and he's yelling because he sees a little car coming. And when you're out in Iowa, and I've had car problems in Iowa, there are not many cars that come by. So he was so excited because here came a car, and he's waving his coat, and he's screaming and trying to get their attention, and they drive by. They didn't stop. So he's like, he's probably been praying since the beginning, but now he's really praying, like, dear Jesus, I am stuck under this harrow, and I need to get off the train track. The train is coming at 4:00. Please, please help me. 3:15, and another car comes by. So he gets his coat and he's waving it up in the air and help, 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 and the car goes by and they don't stop. It's 3:30. Dear Jesus, please help me. The tractor is stuck on me and I can't move and the train is coming at 4. There's another car. So he gets ready, gets his coat, and he's waving it, and he's yelling, and they go by. But there's another car. So he gets his coat, and he's waving and yelling, and that car goes by too. Now it's 3:45. In 15 minutes, the 4 o'clock train is going to come. So Grandpa's prayer changed a little bit. He was like, okay, God, if I don't get off, please be with my wife. Please be with my 3 girls. It's 3:45. It's 3:50. He's still stuck. It is so cold. His whole body is numb. His leg has been stuck. He can't even feel it anymore. But he hears a sound. So he's kind of stuck, and he's looking. Like, it sounds like it's on the track, but it's not 4 o'clock yet. And that train is always on time. So he looks, and he sees a hand car. So a hand car is not a train, but it rides on the train track. It's like got the train type of wheels, but it's just sort of a flat board, and there were men that were pumping with their hands up and down, kind of like a seesaw, and they were making it move, and they were pumping very fast because they also knew the 4 o'clock train was coming, and they needed to get off the track. So they were pumping and pumping and pumping, and right before this crossing where the tractor was, there was like a little bit of track that went off to the side. So they were pumping, and they put the hand car off the track, and they looked over, and they were like, what are you doing? There's a train coming. You need to get off the track. And Grandpa says, I know. Help me. So one of the men, he said, please put the brake on the tractor. So one man put the brake on the tractor, and the 3 other men lifted up the harrow, and Grandpa kind of like rolled out, and he couldn't really feel his legs, but he hobbled over, and he climbed up, and he started the tractor, and they moved it, and he pulled it off. Now the harrow's off because the men were holding it so it wouldn't get stuck again. And they got it off, and he just turned the tractor, and choo-choo! What do you think came around the corner? The 4 o'clock train. That's right. And now Grandpa turned the tractor, and so he sees the train coming, and trains come mighty fast. And the conductor's in the front, and he waves to Grandpa, and he waves to the men. Hi, everyone. And Grandpa's like, hi. You have no idea what could have happened. How do you think my grandpa felt at that moment? He had been mightily worried. He had been. But now he was safe. And how do you think he felt? Those men came. Yeah. Very happy and probably very grateful. Because he had made a mistake. He forgot to set the brake and then he got stuck. But here's the great thing. Even though we make mistakes, and every single one of us makes mistakes, God still loves us, and we are still worth saving. And those men, my grandpa loved this part. He was like, those men were my angels. And I don't know if they were angels that looked like men on a hand car, or if they were men that God said, today you are going to be my angels. But angels saved my grandpa. And you might be an angel for God someday. Maybe you don't pick a harrow off a railroad track, but sometimes when we help people, sometimes when we hug them or give them a smile, we might be their angel that day. So, thank you for listening, and now it's time to get your blue buckets.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather here in the harbor of your safety, we thank you for fellowship and family. We ask that you will strengthen us, restore us, and inspire us with your love. Lord, would you fill us with your peace so that as we journey onwards, we would pour out your love and grace to others. We ask that our souls would catch the wind of your spirit so that we would take your promises to all the earth. Amen. And let us pray as you taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not unto temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from Ezekiel 36, verses 24 through 29. For I will gather you up from all the nations and bring you home again to your land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you and you will be clean. Your filth will be washed away and you will no longer worship idols. And I will give you a new heart. And I will put a new spirit in you. I will take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart. And I will put my spirit in you so that you will follow my decrees and be careful to obey my regulations. And you will live in Israel, the land I gave your ancestors long ago. You will be my people, and I will be your God. I will cleanse you of your filthy behavior. I will give you good crops of grain, and I will send no more famines on the land.
Thank you. The New Testament reading is from Colossians chapter 3, verses 10 through 14. Put on your new nature and be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. In this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or a Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric, uncivilized, slave or free. Christ is all that matters, and He lives in all of us. Since God chose you to be the holy people He loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults, and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. May the Lord add His blessing to the reading of the word.
All right, good morning, church. All right, God is good. And all the time. All right, I'm so glad to be here today. When I think about how God woke me up this morning and I came, I'm just so thankful. And I know that you all are probably just as thankful as I am. We're in 2018 and things are still going good. I know that God woke us up and He has a purpose for us and He has a destiny for us. So we account it for that, and we just want to say we're grateful for having made it this far. As I say that, I say that I may not be worthy of what God has done for me, of Him waking me up every morning, of Him giving me new life and new breath, but I have been counted worthy by Him through His grace, so I'm very grateful. In 1 Timothy 1:15, Paul says that Jesus died for sinners, for whom I'm the worst of sinners. What made Him say this, I wondered. His past, of course, made Him say this. Formerly, Paul was known as the persecutor of the brethren, who Jesus interjected and said to him, "Paul, why are you persecuting me?" In Acts 8:2, Saul had been going house to house seeking out Christians to persecute. He made it his mission to work against the kingdom of God. And just like me and you, we were at some point all enemies of God. Just like Paul, we were all at some point rebellious and out of God's path, knowing or unknowingly. And although Paul has called himself the greatest sinner, we have all felt the weight of our own sins in our lives. But when Jesus saves us, He truly sets us free from all that guilt. John 8:36 says, "Who the Son sets free is free indeed." Right, so after Paul had been transformed and was baptized, he went out and started telling people about what God had done for him. He went back to the synagogue, to his old community, to his neighborhood, and started talking about how the very man he had been fighting against was in fact the true Son of God and the Messiah. You can only imagine the surprise of his old friends, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They hated it. They were amazed at first, but then they tried to kill him because they liked him better as a sinner. He changed, right? They liked him better when he was doing the bad things that allowed them to feel justified. So when he woke up, they saw him as a threat and they wanted to kill him. He also went to the disciples, but the disciples were afraid and at first unwilling to believe that he'd changed. But it's no surprise that there are people that aren't going to take you seriously when you transform or when God does something amazing and significant in your life. You see, Paul was willing to be a team player because through him, people were already getting blessed. People were already being being freed. People were already being positively impacted by his testimony and what he spoke. But yet, some of the disciples didn't accept him. And I asked the question, who is responsible for that? The devil was responsible for the fear and skepticism. But it was them, it was the disciples that stood to lose the most from their fear and their unacceptance. To them, it didn't matter that Paul had completely changed his life through Jesus. It didn't matter that he was bringing something genuine and different to the table. They clung to his past. But in fact, he was a changed man with a new mission. He now knew who he was. He knew what he was supposed to do. There was no turning back. It didn't matter what his family thought of him. It didn't matter what his friends thought of him. He was a changed man. From this story, I get three things. I get number one, which is the point that God can change absolutely anyone. There is nothing that you can do, whether bad. There is no path that you can be on, whether your own righteous path. If God wants to use you, he will stop you, and he will turn you around. He'll even blind you, you know, until you turn yourself around. Point number two, some people may not like it when you change. In fact, they may not get it. They may question if you are a new person. But in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says that I am a new creation in Christ, right? And Isaiah 43:19 says, Jesus said, see, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? Some people are not going to get you because God is trying to do a new thing in you. You're not supposed to be like everybody else. You're not supposed to be ordinary. You're supposed to be genuine and unique and maybe a little bit crazy, a little bit passionate and driven. But that's what God wants. He wants to use that in you, right? We know that Paul was a headstrong person, very determined and driven. That same character that drove him to go persecute Christians, God used that to use him to stand before crowds, to stand in front of the very same Pharisees and to speak about God and how passionate he was and how true he was. Point number three is that you are never too far gone. It doesn't matter to the Lord what you've done in the past. All that matters is that your heart is in the right position to step into where he wants to take you. Who you were and what you did in the past has a lot to do with where God is leading you in the future. Because your history always prepares you for destiny. Romans 8:29 says, for those whom he foretold, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. And to those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. I just want to bring a reminder back to recognize what it is that we actually deal with when we meet people that don't always get us and don't always accept us. We need to remember that it's only the devil that brings up the past. Anytime someone steps into your atmosphere and talks to you about what you used to do, not who you are now, or where you used to be and not where you are now. Anytime they want to bring up what you did in the old days and bring hesitation into you, that's not God talking to you. That is the devil trying to bring up the old you to keep you from going forth into what you were meant to be. The devil will call you by your sin, but God calls you by your destiny. Amen. The devil will remind you of what you used to do and who you used to be, but God says, that's already over. I've transformed you. I've completely forgotten about that. I needed to talk to you about the future because I have called you and positioned you for such a time as this. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. So is that true for you, or is it not? Are you going to choose to believe it every day, or are you not? Remember, you are still on the potter's wheel. For the time that remains until Jesus returns and takes us up to heaven, we are still incomplete beings, so no one has the right to hold anything present or past against you. I want to leave off with Romans 8:19, which says, "The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. Yes, we all have a past. But isn't it glorious and isn't it marvelous that Jesus made us new? Isn't it glorious and isn't it marvelous that he set us on this path, knowing that we would be the very people we are now because he wants to use us?"
Thank you, Percy. I like that line, God calls us by our destiny. You know, the dark forces would call us by our past. Yeah. So when Percy told me what she was going to focus on, I naturally thought, I've got to find an animal story to go with this. So I visited the farm early last week or the week before. I drove in the driveway, drove all the way to the back toward where the barn is. And out of the barn comes my granddaughter, about this big. The dog at her side, wagging her tail. And in her arms is a sack of potatoes. And she comes out, big grin on her face, coming to the car, and she's halfway to the car, and she falls, drops a sack of potatoes, falls on top of the sack of potatoes, whimpers a little bit, and then when she sees that I'm not alarmed by the fact she fell over, she gets herself together, gets back up, scoops up the sack of potatoes again, and heads toward the car. I was watching a conversion as dramatic as the conversion of Saul to Paul. Because this sack of potatoes was not a sack of potatoes. This was a cat. This was Jack the cat. Jack came to our house 15 years ago as a wild animal. You could not get anywhere near him. Over the years, he became a little less wild. But still, if I walked in the barn and he was on the ground, you know, he would get back under something. If I moved quickly, he would disappear. The only time he would let me get close to him if he was up on the shelf where we would feed the cats, and then I could come over and scratch his head as long as he was up there. But he's a wild cat. If you visited our house, you have probably never seen Jack, because when people come, Jack disappears. If people will come, he will disappear for hours. It's like, have you seen Jack? Well, no, somebody was here a couple hours ago, so we won't see him for a while. He's gone. Jack is a wild cat. And here I see Kyra coming out of the barn with Jack spread-eagled in her arms, on his back. She stumbles and falls, lands on top of him, and instead of running off, he lies there, waits until she gets to her feet, and waits for her to pick him up again, and she does. And I'm looking at this going, Is that the same animal? I guess instead of being a wild cat, he's now a lover cat. And I've got a picture to prove it. It's amazing. In Christianity, we appropriately celebrate stories of conversion. And Paul, Saul becoming Paul, is kind of the model, the template for the glorious stories we tell. You know, as Percy highlighted, nobody so far, God can somehow get a hold of people. One of my friends, when I met him, when he first started coming to church, was a homeless meth addict. And if you know meth addiction, this is a death sentence. After 4 or 5 times in rehab, he was clean and sober, went off to college, began working as a geologist, of all things. You know, it's a wonderful conversion story. We appropriately celebrate those stories. But Percy was telling me what she was thinking, was going to talk about, I was thinking, yeah, but what if you're old? What if you have been a Christian for 5 years already? Or 13, or whatever it is, or 73, or 99. What does being a new creature look like if you're not going from being horrible to being decent? You know, the story of Jack is a wonderful story if you're a jerk. Because it says you can quit being a jerk and become a nice person. Right? But what if you're already a nice person? Because you've been walking with God for a long time. What does conversion look like? Remember, there were two animals with Kyra when she came out of the barn. One was the sack of potatoes in her arm, Jack the cat. And the other was the dog at her side. Now, don't ask my wife about the details because she will correct my story, okay? So just stay with me. My version of this story is that the dog that was at Kyra's side has been good all her life. She was born in a box under our kitchen table. We have watched this dog from day one. She's always been a good dog, a friendly dog. A perfect dog. Well, almost. So what's new? How can Rexy do anything new except go downhill? How can you do something new if you have, in fact, been walking with God? Well, you have available to you the same thing Rexy has available to her. There's always a new day. And today, you can live in the identity that is yours. Today, to borrow the bumper sticker, we can wag more. The way Rexy experiences conversion is she finds somebody else to wag at. She finds somebody else to smile at. She finds another way to be patient with the grandkids who are sometimes rough. And that's what God calls us to do, to live in our identity. If our identity is not in Christ, if we are alienated from God and humanity, you know, the story that Percy points us to, the story of Paul, Saul, who became Paul, God calls us inside. And now that we are inside, God calls us to live. You notice that in this text, Paul linked newness, and he said, you know, once you're in Christ, Doesn't matter whether you're Jewish or Greek, barbarian or civilized, male or female, slave or free. There is a powerful identity that is ours because we are in Christ. And we celebrate that here in church. You notice that here in this beautiful public space, there is no flag. Why? Because in this space, our national identities are irrelevant. You know, whether we're Mexican or English or Russian or Texan or Oregonian or Tennessean, those are all precious parts of our identity. And on International Sabbath, we celebrate it. And then we bring all the flags in because that's part of who we are. But in this place, there is only one supreme identity. We are one in Christ, invited and called to live that identity forward every day in compassion, in integrity, truth-telling, faithfulness, and then as one of the passages that Percy ended with, forgiveness. We forgive one another so that every day we can begin again to live our new life in Christ.
Thank you.
Let's pray. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.